Hello and good morning to UPSCSeva.com's Economic Survey 2016 series. So today we are going to see the chapter number 5, volume 1 of Economic Survey. So in this volume, many topics are covered like maternal and child issues, tax benefits for the wealthy, preferential trade agreements, reforming the fertilizer sector and reforming the labor sector in India. Starting with mother and child, a healthy mother shall give birth to a healthy child, and thus we say skill begets skill. The studies have shown that the effect more programs on the health and nutrition of a child are taken during the early infanthood, then the ability of these programs to affect the income and test scores and education level of a child is high. There are many externalities, negative externalities that affect the infant health. So these factors reduce the impact of the child's development, mental and physical. And one such impact is open defecation. India has the highest percentage of open defecation in South Asia, while it has been completely or almost completely eradicated in neighboring countries like Sri Lanka, Bangladesh and Bhutan. So due to this problem of open defecation, our infants are affected with nutritional disorders, worms, etc. And so this problem has to be solved very immediately. The next issue in the economic survey is subsidies for the rich. 4.2% of our GDP goes into subsidies, and these subsidies benefit both rich as well as poor. The government has many small saving instruments like postal savings, public provident fund, tax-free bonds, etc. And needy as well as the rich invest out of this. The PPF and tax-free bonds are not exactly small saving instruments. The high rate of interest offered by these instruments means that monetary policy is affected, and interest rates of the banks in deposits as well as loans is not reduced. So even when the Reserve Bank reduces the deposit rate like the CRR or the repo rate, the same cannot be passed on to the consumers by the banks. The economic survey recommends us to move from the exempt strategy to the exempt tax EET strategy, where when money is put into savings, it becomes exempt from taxation. While it is in the savings, if any interest is earned, even that is not taxed. But the taxation applies at the point of exit, and it is applied only on the interest. So this is the EET scheme, which the economic survey recommends us to move to. The reason that the tax incentive is a saving leads to exempt tax or EET is a very powerful means to ensure that subsidies are not misused, and since there is a tax at the end of the scheme while the savings are being withdrawn, it encourages the account holder or the investor to not spend the money on this savings. So there is a combined effect of taxation as well as the penalizing of this savings that encourages a person to save more for retirement. EET savings also increase the confidence in the investor. However, such decisions when taken by the government are usually met with huge backlash. And so, if these policies have to be implemented, then first consensus will have to be built amongst the people. The EET records are easy to maintain as everything is done in a single account and all transactions and taxes will be paid while withdrawing that amount on maturity. So EET is a very effective way. The second alternative to EET is TEE, which is tax exempt exempt. In this, when the amount is invested in a small saving instrument, it is not tax deductible. However, once it is in that instrument and it generates interest, That interest is not taxable, and even when the final amount is withdrawn after maturity, that amount is also exempt from taxation. So this is TEE. And in the economy, in this current budget of 2017, many economists have recommended to the finance minister to move these small saving instruments to TEE mode. The next topic is preferential trade agreements. There are five main types of preferential trade agreements in the world. One is the partial scope agreement. In this, free trade is allowed between two countries or, you know, many countries, but on a limited number of goods. The next is the free trade agreement. Members reduce tariff or duties for trade with each other, but maintain it for non-members. Customs union. In this, members apply a common external tariff for trade with non-members. Then the fourth type is common market. In this, the factors of production like labor, capital, etc. can be moved very easily between the member countries of a common market. And finally, economic union. In this, the member countries of a economic union coordinate with each other to decide the exchange rate and the macroeconomic policies. So these five types of trade agreements are provided in the economic survey. There is a high controversy regarding the misuse of free trade agreements because it seems that it does not benefit the country as much in terms of trade. However, the imports increase after a free trade agreement. Plus, due to the free trade agreement, we cannot tax those imports and so customs duty is lost. Thus, it is a need to examine these free trade agreements and see whether the country is benefiting from them or not. Finally, reforming the fertilizer sector. So, currently the government has taken a very important step in reforming the fertilizer sector by neem coating urea. This prevents diversion of urea to industrial uses or gas pooling industrial uses, and so most of the urea will be available to the farmers. Also, gas pooling will increase efficiency of urea production, and both these steps are taken in the right direction by the government. Normal urea is prone to nitrogen loss on account of leaching or volatilization. But by neem coating, we ensure that the release of nitrogen is slow and so soil absorbs urea efficiently. Less amount of urea is required in farming due to the neem coating. So less amount of urea is produced, less amount of subsidy is there, and so there is huge savings. Then some statistics related to the fertilizer sector are given. Every year 73,000 crore rupees is set aside as fertilizer subsidy, out of which 70% goes to urea. Of this, a majority is diverted to industrial uses or goes to the rich farmers or is exported illegally, and only 35% of the subsidy reaches the real beneficiaries. The problem with urea subsidy is that it encourages overuse of urea, it causes environmental harm, it also causes market distortions, it promotes inefficient factories that produce urea, and it also doesn't encourage fertilizer units to open their factories or branches everywhere. This is because the fertilizer subsidy is not paid to the farmer, but it is paid to the fertilizer company. And so, a fertilizer company has no encouragement to open its business in other parts of the country, since it knows that it has the monopoly in that sector. The other problems are that 82% of the fertilizers produced is urea, 74% of the fertilizer consumed is also urea, and 52% of the fertilizer imported is again urea. The government control over urea sector is so complicated that the economic survey has listed five different segments in it. It decides who shall import urea and how much shall he import. It places a cap on the maximum retail price of urea. it directs fertilizer company where to sell their products and also in how much quantity it can sell. It provides subsidy to fertilizer units and not to the farmers. The subsidy on urea is consignment specific to the importers. So all these problems create a black market economy for urea, while the real beneficiaries for whom the subsidy is meant have to buy it for MRP or above MRP prices because of a thriving black market for urea. The solution is that direct benefit transfer should be started in the fertilizer sector and subsidy should be paid directly to the farmer based on per hectare, based on their land holdings. Or the second alternative is that once the farmer goes to a fertilizer outlet and authenticates his identity biometrically using either his fingerprints or eye scans, then the fertilizer outlet can give him the urea fertilizer. So this is the biometrically authenticated system which was discussed in the last video. Urea should also be brought under the nutrient-based subsidy scheme, and factories of urea fertilizer should be encouraged to open their plants in foreign countries where the energy cost is low, so fertilizer can be manufactured cheaply. But in order to do so, the government must first shift fertilizer subsidy payment from the units to the farmers. The last point in the Economic Survey Volume 1 is labor reforms. Labor reforms were seen as a significant barrier to growth. Labor regulations were seen as a significant barrier to growth, with stringent dismissal norms under the Industrial Dispute Act. It is almost impossible to dismiss a worker due to the strict regulations of the Industrial Disputes Act, and therefore the contract labor is on rise. Under this, almost 25% of the registered manufacturing workers are contract based. Contract labor has very few advantages, but contract labor is usually costlier than employment on roll, and also it is not beneficial to the company as contractual employees are not full-time devoted to their job as the permanent employee. The labor regulation system in India is very complex due to the high number of laws, and plus central as well as state dual control over the industries. The contract labor system is now increasing also because companies try to keep their labor force small. Since the Industrial Act applies only to companies with more than 200 employees, the companies deliberately keep their employment role small in order to evade the labor norms. Therefore, these labor reforms have to be implemented if the labor sector has to benefit. In India, you should note that 82% of the labor is unorganized and only 18% of the labor is under the organized sector. And so any labor reform taken will benefit a large number of people. The government has implemented many labor reforms, and a few of them are mentioned in our India Yearbook series. You can read them in here under the India Yearbook series. So right, that was it, and thank you for watching this video. See you next time. Best of luck.